Hi, I'm Mars, and today we're going to talk about variable management in YarnSpinner. So variables are things that we use to store values that we want to persist while we're playing our game. That might be for something about our dialogue, such as saying what the player said their name was, or how much money the player has, or some other value. Or it also might be something that we use in our C#, in our case for Unity, that we use for game logic, decisions about what the player can or cannot do, or what they end up with when they do a certain action, such as how much money they have left when they buy something. And when we're dealing with YarnSpinner and YarnSpinner for Unity, we can sometimes end up with two sides of this equation. We have variables in the yarn side that we use in our yarn script, and you can tell these by the ones that start with a dollar sign. And then we have variables in C#. And when people start using these two things together, start going into their variable storage on the C# side, or start doing logic that requires variables that come from both of these places, the thing that everyone immediately reaches for is to duplicate these variables. You have one on the C# side and one on the yarn side. They might have the same name, and you're going to use them interchangeably in the different places that you need them. Unfortunately, then we run into this duplication problem. So here we are in C#, and we're going to implement some game logic that requires values from both the YarnSpinner side and then code run on the C# side. Here we have a handle to the variable storage of the currently running dialogue runner from YarnSpinner, and this is how we'll access the values that YarnSpinner is currently storing. Then we have a float value for the current number of coins that a player has. On startup, we're getting a handle to the current variable storage, and now we're going to implement a function by which the player is given extra coins. Here we've gotten that C# side player coins, and we've updated it by the requested amount. Now the C# side of this equation has the right amount of coins. However, to check that the player coins on the C# side started from the correct initial value, we first need to get the value that YarnSpinner thinks for that variable. Say we have a variable in YarnSpinner called player_coins that's storing any changes to the player coin amount that are done through dialogue. Now we've updated that amount, and you might think we're done, but in fact, we've fallen into that trap. Right now, the C# side of the equation, player coins in Pascal case, thinks that the player coins amount was the initial amount from the YarnSpinner side plus the new amount. Let's say the initial amount was 4 coins. And using try_get value, we've passed that value into C#. We've added some amount, let's say +2. Now the C# side thinks that player coins is 6. But the YarnSpinner side still thinks that player coins is 4. We haven't done that update. So we need to do that side as well. Store that change back. So now we have get to get the initial value from YarnSpinner. We have increment to change the amount. And then we have setback to tell YarnSpinner that that value has changed. Now both the C# and the yarn variables hold the same value for sure. But if you're doing this a lot, all over your code, forgetting one or two of those steps, either forgetting to get the initial value so that player coins might start from the wrong number, or forgetting to set it back so that the yarn side is never updated, told about this change, all of a sudden you'll end up with weird bugs. And so now we're going to talk about 4 different alternatives you might implement as patterns to manage your 2 different kinds of variables so that you don't fall into this trap with your games. And the best idea will depend on how your game is using these values. The first 2 options are just to pick one side of the equation, only use one kind of variables. You might elect to only use yarn variables. Say if your values are changing and being used frequently in your yarn scripts, but infrequently in your C# side. In the case of the player's currency, this might change through dialogue options such as deciding to bribe a guard to get through a gate. The number of coins a player has will go down. Or doing a favor for an NPC, where the number of coins they have might go up. However, in your C# side, you might only have basic things, such as checking whether the player has enough money to go through a certain action. You might instead elect to only use C# values if, in the YarnSpinner side, you're only querying for the value held by these variables infrequently, but the C# side is using it throughout all different game systems to make different kinds of decisions, or it's being set by complex logic. For example, if you have a whole marketplace implementation where people need to be able to buy and sell or negotiate or have complex methods of discount based on player stats, then maybe you'd want to manage all of this on the C# side instead. Another option is when you, as a game developer, want to have a complex method of save system or storing state that has to be managed by the C-sharp side. You might instead want to have yarn values that are used throughout your script, but that are set in their initial values from C-sharp. And then you want on shutdown for those currently updated values in the yarn script to go back. But while the game is running, not many changes are happening on the C-sharp side. So you might instead have this load and store model, where when the game starts up, it asks C-sharp, hey, what initial value should my yarn variables have? And when the game is shutting down, yarn says, here, take these updated values, store them the way you will. Or, if you genuinely have reason to use both of these kinds of variables, you need to use them frequently and in complex logic on both the C-sharp and yarn spinner sides. You can instead have a wrapper class that will present that single value in these two different places as a false interface, often using properties. So we'll talk about each of these in more detail. So here we have a basic yarn script that declares a single variable of type number. It's the number of coins the player currently has. They start out with 0 coins, and through different dialogue choices, that number may change. Here we've got a new version of that C-sharp script with that same add player currency function. But instead of there being a persistent C-sharp side variable called player coins, we're instead using a temporary variable for our try get value function. This is then populated by the tryGetValue function, and if that returns false, which means the variable store does not have a variable with this name, it instead gives it the default starting value, which we've declared as 0. The player should start with 0 coins if they've never interacted with anything. Then we're going to update that amount as we set that value back to the variable store. And this variable temp on the C-sharp side just goes away when this function ends, and there is no C-sharp side persistent variable whatsoever. Now this might seem like a bit worse syntax, but in fact, it's not any extra work for your computer to do. This variable storage is storing this value anyway in a dictionary or whatever your implementation of variable storage is in C-sharp's memory. Now, instead of having another variable that's just storing the exact same value and doing all these sync operations, we're just asking for the place that is already stored. The other option is to only use C-sharp variables. Here is that same script in yarn, but instead of using a variable on the yarn spinner side that's been declared at the beginning, we're using functions. Every time we want to get or change the value of the player coins variable, we ask C-sharp to do that with a variable that it is managing. So now we've got the same script, but this time we're not going to have any yarn side variables. Instead, we're going to let C-sharp handle all access and modification of this value. This time, we're going to get the dialogue runner instead of the variable storage, and we're going to add functions that allow getting and changing of this value. Now we have player coins stored back on the C-sharp side, and we can do some more complex logic, such as saying the maximum amount of coins that the player is allowed to hold at one time, and the inferred minimum of 0. We have a function to get the current number of player coins. We have functions to set to a specific number, such as, I'm going to take all your coins, no matter how many that is, and you're going to end up with 0. Or add or subtract, which is being given or spending a certain amount. Here, these functions can now check that a certain condition is met, and return whether or not that command was successful. This way, in our script, we can say, you can have another coin, but only if that was allowed. Only if you don't already have the maximum. And this is really great for any commands that need to change a value, but also need to check if certain parameters are met, certain constraints about the player behavior. Then you don't have to write all those limiters in yarn. So again, we're not storing any values in yarn. In fact, the variable storage for yarn right now has no player declared variables, but we're providing accesses that let the yarn script use it in a similar way, just by asking C-sharp to change or give a variable. Then we have the load and store model, where we want to take an initial snapshot of what the variable storage should look like, put that into yarn, run our gameplay, and then put those values back on save. Here we have that same yarn script as our first one. They used only yarn variables, but we've made a call to a command here called load variables. This happens after the declarations of variables, but before the beginning of our dialogue. And this ensures that before any player logic is run, any choices are presented to the player, or they're given any dialogue that might interpolate variable values, we've instead gotten the initial values from C#. This script is a little bit longer, because here we've needed a handle to the variable store and the dialogue runner. The dialogue runner needs commands to load and store variables so that we can ask it when to get and set those values from the C# side. We've also got a variable store handle so that we can tell it, here, take this initial state, or here, give me your final state that I need to save. These are then used in functions load variables and store variables on the C# side. And there are definitely cleverer ways that you can set this so that you won't even have to run a command. It might be able to automatically detect startup and shutdown. Right now, these are just using local dictionaries that hold a variable name and its current value across the three different types, float, string, and boolean, that YarnSpinner allows. A variable store, in particular our default implementation in-memory variable storage, has a function called setAllVariables that you can pass three dictionaries to, and it will set all of its internal memory to exactly these values. Similarly, there is a getAllVariables, which will give back those three dictionaries that can be set back on the C# side. We're accessing these items in a tuple that are returned. You might want to do something more complicated here. Right now, we've got two empty dictionaries for our string variables and our Boolean variables, and our float variables holds only one variable. In a more complex game, you might have dozens of variables. And you still want this to persist when you shut down your game. The C# memory is not persisted when you quit either, when a process stops running. So instead, before you load variables and after you store variables from the C# side, you probably want to write some C# code that will put it in a more persistent store, such as here, before you set all variables, reading in the values from a file that you saved on disk. Similarly, when you store variables, you probably want to save them out somewhere as well. The most important part here is that these dictionaries are not being used as local storage. In fact, you should do away with them altogether. If, like we said earlier, your set variables was reading in from a file on disk and your store variables was reading out, you could get rid of these C# pass-through variables whatsoever and instead only use variables that are scoped to these functions. That would be much cleaner. And you can see the YarnSpinner documentation for examples of how you can serialize and deserialize this information to disk format, such as JSON. The final option is to duplicate your variables, but there are ways that let you access these values neatly in the same syntax on the C# side and on the Yarn side as you would if you had both types of variables, but they refer to the same underlying memory. And this way you aren't responsible for keeping these in sync, and that's going to prevent some of these pesky bugs. So here we have that same original Yarn file that looks as if we're only using YarnSpinner variables. But then in our C# script, we're instead using variable storage dot player coins, and we're making the variable storage responsible for managing this property. Here we've implemented a subclass of the variable storage, the default implementation that comes with YarnSpinner, but we've added a property called player coins. This automatically, when you get this property, like you would any variable, asks the underlying variable storage what its current value is. And when you set it back, it sets it back. This way, when you're saying variable storage dot player coins, you are doing that try get value, change value, set value round trip, but you're not responsible for doing that every time you access this property. Instead, you can treat the variable store as if it's holding locally managed variables and do with it what you would any normal C# variables. But they'll still act the same on the YarnSpinner side, and they'll always stay in sync. This is a much cleaner pattern to prevent the duplication trap. And using the variable store dot property name pattern is a much cleaner syntax hint to the people using these values that this is a YarnSpinner managed value, and that it might be changed by parts of the code that they can't see. So now let's summarize our four options. You can use variables only in Yarn, and every time you go into C# and you need to get those values, you use the variable storage, try get value, and set value accesses. You only keep temporarily scoped variables in C#, and you make sure they're done away with when you're finished using them. No persistent store on the C# side. You use only C# values, which means you have no variables declared on the YarnSpinner side, and these are not stored in the YarnSpinner variable storage. Instead, you only access and change these values via functions that are declared on the dialog runner in C#. You use the load and store model, which means your C# code will load the initial values from somewhere and inject this into your variable storage when needed. And then when things close, they store them back. YarnSpinner does all management of the variables during runtime, but is not responsible for their initial values that are set in the beginning, and It can persist through playthroughs to make sure that the final values stored by it at the end of a run will be the initial values next time. The final one is duplicated, or seemingly duplicated variables, where you have a property with accesses that instead ask the yarn variable storage for that value. So you're using the same underlying memory, you just have different syntax to access both from the yarn side and the C# side as needed. You can check out more YarnSpinner documentation and tutorials on our website, support us on Patreon, or join our Discord to have a chat to our fantastic community. Thanks.